Well, I want to say thank you to Lauren and Phil for your introduction this morning and for inviting me to participate in the seminar this afternoon. It's my pleasure to join you again for another seminar, another topic. And I hope this is going to be helpful, and I'm pretty sure we'll generate a lot of conversation once I'm done making the presentation. The presentation will be about 35, 40 minutes or so at the very, very most. And then we'll be able to do questions and comments and dialogue over this. I see a lot of friends. I've clicked through the screens a number of times here to see who's present and who's there. I see people from Europe. I see Daniel. I see Yvonne. People from the Netherlands, people from Sweden. People from Florida and all the way to California. So I'm glad to see a lot of you. A lot of you I know well. And of course, some of you are probably new here to this presentation. I have made this presentation four times in the last 2 months, maybe 3 months. So it started with one presentation at Sligo Sabbath School, sometimes in March or April. And then people were there and saw it and wanted it in their Sabbath school. So I've done PUC, I've done here at Andrews, and now here at Adventist Today. Now the advantage is that Adventist Today is in the afternoon for the Eastern time zone, while the other presentations were in the morning. So it gives an opportunity for a different group of people. So here we go. I will share my screen. I have prepared a PowerPoint presentation, and you can follow along as I go. Let me begin with a Bible text taken from the end of Paul's letter to the Thessalonians in chapter 5. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything and hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. In these verses here, verses 20 and 21 in particular, that we as Adventists have used quite extensively in our doctrine of spiritual gifts, more specifically our doctrine of the gift of prophecy. These two verses, is Paul inviting the Thessalonians to exercise a measure of judgment in their religious expressions? Is he inviting to discriminate to some extent, to evaluate critically what they believe and accept as part of their religious experience? Well, perhaps he is. And what about us, 200 years after the beginning of the Millerite movement? In 106 years or so after the death of Ellen White. As we look at our history, as we look at the past, how do we, not quench the spirit, yet at the same time test everything and hold fast to what is good? Somehow there's an invitation here to critical thinking, to reflection, a little bit of judgment, a little bit of evaluation, of analysis, of sifting through ideas and holding fast to what is good. Now, this is not an easy task for the Seventh-day Adventist Church in general, for scholars, for church members. And like many others, as we study our history, perhaps this phrase spoken by W.W. Prescott, at the time one of the vice president of the General Conference, also the director of the Department of Education for our church, who said, I have had to adjust my view of things. After evaluating, judging, discriminating a little bit, analyzing all kinds of things that had happened in the Adventist history that he knew, he had to adjust his view of things. So here are lessons from the 1919 Bible Conference. This presentation was first given about a year and a half ago in San Diego, California. That year, I was the president of the Adventist Society for Religious Studies. It is the oldest Adventist society of theology and religion scholars. I was the president that year. It was my responsibility, therefore, to give the address, the keynote address for the conference. Our theme that year was 1919. 1919 was a momentous year in Adventism because of this Bible conference, but also it was a momentous year in the world. It was the year of the Paris Conference that wrapped up World War I, or the Great War in Europe. It is also the year that a number of very seminal books in theology were printed, one by Karl Barth on the Book of Romans, and so on. So that address was given in November of 1919, and then was published in Spectrum also a few weeks later in their magazine. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to pause a moment and shut my window. I've got a number of sparrows right outside my windows that are louder than I am, I think. So just a moment. Okay, there we go. I'm sorry for the little pause here. I got a bird feeder right outside my window, and they're really taking advantage of it here this afternoon. Okay, so let me come back here. So I gave this presentation a year and a half ago in San Diego to the world of our scholars. And since then, as I've mentioned, a number of people have wanted me to address the topic that I presented. So you can find this presentation in a scholarly form in the Spectrum magazine, and also in the online edition. History shows that a religious group's beliefs change over time. Most of the time, these changes are perceived as being harmful to the original identity and mission of the group. Such changes, if too big or too numerous, may lead to schisms and the formation of another group who is either more faithful to its pioneers or more progressive as it moves away from restrictive views. The thought is that religious groups change over time. None are static. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is not immune to this phenomenon, even if church leaders are warning constantly against it. You know, don't become secular, don't do this, don't do that, don't accept this point of view or that point of view, and so on. Numerous independent ministries and colleges have attempted to feed off this phenomenon by claiming to be more faithful to the original intent of the pioneers by themselves remaining faithful to their ideas and practices. Albeit, very seldom is this really the case. For Adventism, as we know, our beliefs have changed over the years. Changes in beliefs have happened and will continue to happen within the Seventh-day Adventist Church just as much as it happened or happens in many, many other Christian religious groups. If we take, for example, since the days of Joseph Bates, who is arguably probably the first theologian, scholar of our church, we certainly have changed when it comes to considering the divinity of Christ. Joseph Bates was Arian. We have changed in our triune understanding of who God is. We have changed from limited views of Christ's ministry in the sanctuary to be very broad-minded now and very embracing now regarding some of these views. We certainly have changed regarding the meaning of the death of Christ on the cross and its relationship to the ministry of Christ in the sanctuary. We also have changed regarding the role of obedience in salvation. All of these things have happened, and these are just a few points, since the time of Joseph Bates, 170-some years ago. One of the first theologians to try to document this and to try to explain this was Leroy Froom, professor at the seminary in the 1960s and 1970s, and he chronicled that in his 1971 book, Movement of Destiny. A book that has been criticized from the right, from the left, perhaps not always very objective, but be that as it may, at least it was an attempt describing some of the doctrinal changes that have happened since the beginning of Adventism until about the 1960s when he wrote the book. Now, other theologians since the time of Froome have done this as well. The best known among us is George Knight. Certainly well-known, dozens of books, many of them on Adventist theology and the development of Adventist theology. The best book of that series is probably A Search for Identity that he published in the early 2000s, in which he described the development of some Seventh-day Adventist beliefs. A phenomenal book that really built on what Leroy Froome had done. More recently, in the last 2 years, 3 years, two books have come out from George Knight. End Time Events in the Last Generation, a historical approach to the development of the doctrine of the last generation and how it occurred in the 1950s and 60s and all the debates regarding this. This is a little bit more of a historical presentation. And then 2 years ago, Ellen White's Afterlife, in which George Knight chronicles what happened to our understanding of the role and the intent of the writings of Ellen White after she died. The book begins before she dies and then goes into the fundamentalist period of time of our church of the 1920s, 30s, 40s, and then what has happened since then. I will refer to this book a number of times here this afternoon, and I would really invite you to get a hold of this book if you don't have it, perhaps to continue the conversation regarding what I'll present here this afternoon. So Ellen White's Afterlife by George Knight. Changes in beliefs are not often planned or premeditated. Sometimes they happen because of a number of ad hoc circumstances. And sometimes decisions made by church leaders have a tremendous and long-lasting impact on the future of a religious community's of belief. And it's not intended, but sometimes it happens. And I believe that such was the case as a result of discussions and subsequent burying of the transcripts of the 1919 Bible Conference. The Bible Conference happened in July and early August of 1919, so 102 years ago, at Washington Missionary College, which is now Washington Adventist University in Tacoma Park, Maryland. It was a gathering of approximately 100, 120 or so Bible teachers and history teachers and a fair number of administrators as well who had the time or took the time to attend the Bible Conference. Now, as you can tell, the Bible Conference was just a few miles from the GC headquarters in Tacoma Park as well and in Washington, D.C. The topics discussed were the topics really relevant and pertinent to a group of Bible and history teachers in 1919. They had to do with Bible prophecies. Now remember, 1919, that's the year coming out of the Great War, the First World War. And a lot of people had a lot of questions to ask regarding Uriah Smith's interpretation of the Ottoman Empire in the seven plagues, but also in the seven trumpets of the book of Revelation. So a lot of history and Bible prophecies were discussed. How are we to interpret them after the First World War is over? And, you know, things have changed drastically. And the timeline that Uriah Smith had predicted had not happened and was likely not to happen the way that he had prepared the scenario. So how do we do this? How do we go about this? How do we go about reshaping some of these ideas? Of course, all of this therefore comes into play with the inspiration of scripture. Is it inherent? How do you interpret it? So hermeneutics as well. And then, of course, the role of the writings of Ellen White in biblical interpretation of history, Bible prophecy, and the interpretation of difficult subjects like history, science, geology, and so on. So these were the key hot topic issues. And they were discussed morning and afternoon during the Bible conference of these 5 weeks. Sometimes they even added an evening meeting on top of that. And they discussed that all between themselves for these 5 or 6 weeks. Now, if you want a little bit of a summary of the Bible conference, I invite you to take Michael Campbell's little book, 1919, The Untold Story of Adventism, Struggle with Fundamentalism. You'll find it also at the ABC or on Amazon. Michael gives a summary of the Bible conference and of the hot topics. It's a good one to get. I've encouraged Michael to do a deeper study, or at least to publish a deeper study of the Bible conference. This one is at the lay person level, and I think more could be said about the conference as well. But here's where we go as far as our topic for today. Two persons among many made some comments during this Bible conference. And this is why today we still talk about this Bible conference. As I've mentioned, some of the key topics had to do with Bible prophecies, about history, the interpretation of history and prophecy, the role of scripture and the role of Ellen White. And all of that also wrapped up into the concepts of inerrancy, infallibility of the writings of Ellen White. Daniels and Prescott had been two church leaders very intimately connected with Ellen White, with her ministry, and knew very well how she had prepared her books, how she had prepared her testimonies. And during the conference, they made a number of statements that came to haunt the two of them, but also probably because of what they said and of the tone of the conversations, that is probably why the transcripts of the conference were basically buried in the archives of the General Conference after the conference was over. The discussions were thought to be too candid, too honest, that could confuse and probably shock an unknown and uninformed membership. Here are some of the comments that were made. On July 30, 1919, so we're getting close now to the end of the conference. There's only about 10 days left of the conference. They decided that day to have an evening meeting during which they're going to have a focused discussion on the use of Ellen White's writing in our teaching of Bible and history. Well, that had been a hot button conversation all the way through the conference. And that evening, they invited Daniels and Prescott to address that topic from their perspective, having lived closely and having had ministry closely with Ellen White. Daniels begins his comments with this. First of all, I want to reiterate what I stated in the talk I gave some evenings ago on this subject, that I do not want to say one word that will destroy confidence in the gift of Ellen White to this people. I do not want to create doubts. I do not want to in any way depreciate the value of the writings of the Spirit of Prophecy. He was guarded. From the get-go, as you read the transcript, I think you can get a sense that Daniels, Prescott, and a few others are guarded in what they say about Ellen White, her writings, and the role of her writings in sustaining our beliefs, our doctrines, and our interpretations. They were guarded for a number of reasons, two in particular that I'll come to in a moment. But what is happening here is that both Daniels and Prescott had very intimate knowledge of how Ellen White had prepared some of her books. And if they're going to discuss the role of Ellen White in our teaching of Bible and history and the use of Ellen White to sustain some of our interpretations, they needed to talk about the purpose of the books of Ellen White and how they had been put together. And the first example that Daniels gives is the book Sketches from the Life of Paul, a book published in 1883. It is a book that Ellen White had prepared and on the life of Paul, more specifically, a book that later would be incorporated in parts into the book Acts of the Apostles. But not then in 1883. As the book came out, immediately people began to have some questions about the book. You see, Ellen White had never hidden her likes of some other books that she had purchased. One of them had been a book by Connie Baer and Howson on the life and the epistles of St. Paul, a book published by two British scholars on the life and the epistles of Paul, the writings of Paul. Ellen White owned a copy of that book, had read it, and also even announced in the Signs of the Times and the Review and Herald that it would be a good book for anybody to purchase. In fact, the Review and Herald and Signs of the Times office and their little bookstore sold that book. When Ellen White's book came out, Sketches from the Life of Paul, it became very obvious for some people that, oops, that sounds very familiar to what Connie Baer and Howson said in their chapter on the same topic. And look and behold, yes, it is. As you compare some of the chapters of Sketches from the Life of Paul with chapters from Connie Baer and Howson, you can immediately see the parallels. The parallels are not only words being about the same, but some chapters are basically the same outline. They follow the same line of thoughts, the same topics are discussed in the same order, and so on. So immediately something came up here in the life of in the minds of a number of Adventists, thinking Adventists, wanting to know where did Ellen White get her material to prepare her books. A lot of people had the impression that everything that Ellen White wrote from page to page, cover to cover, is the product of a vision. Well, what if it is not a vision? Daniels and Prescott knew that most of the books of Ellen White did not come from visions. For Daniels, this book and how it had been prepared demonstrated to him that Ellen White's inspiration was not a verbal inspiration, you know, words dictated to her mind directly by the Holy Spirit. But rather, it is an inspiration at the level of unique guidance of what to select from another author to use as a spiritual commentary on biblical stories of the life of Paul. Connie Baer and Howson's book was a careful work of scholarship, but not Ellen White's book, and it should not be taken as one, unless people were willing to claim indirectly that Connie Baer and Howson's writings were somehow inspired as well. And of course, no Adventists wanted to go in that direction. So that was one example given. So how do you use Ellen White in biblical interpretation of prophecies? Well, you use her very timidly and very carefully, knowing that she's not a scholar, but that she's more likely doing a spiritual commentary on these prophecies rather than a technical interpretation of the prophecy. That's basically what Daniels was driving at here. But more to the point is the book, The Great Controversy, first published in 1884 as volume 4 of the series, The Spirit of Prophecy, then a standalone book in 1888, and then a revised one in 1911. Now, in preparation for the 1911 edition of The Great Controversy, Ellen White had asked a number of our scholars in our church to go through a number of libraries, particularly the scholarly university libraries in Europe and in the United States, to try to see if they could find better statements regarding the history of the Reformation, of the papacy, of the Middle Ages, and so on, that could be used in her revised edition rather than the older quotes that she had used in the prior editions. One person who submitted the most revisions to the book, both revisions in wording, if the book were to be used for a non-public audience, and also revisions to quotes that she made in the earlier editions of the book, was W.W. Prescott. Now, in the introduction to the 1911 edition, Ellen White explained the process of redaction of the book and the purpose for historical quotes and her dependence on them, on those quotes. It's a very important little chapter of all the writings of Ellen White when it comes to how she wrote her books. Very few people read the introduction to The Great Controversy. Well, Prescott was the colleague who provided her with the most revisions to historical quotes and also recommendations to delete, edit out offensive wording. Well, at first, Prescott explained during the conference, one of those evening meetings, he had not wanted to do this research for her because he could not understand how his assistance could be incorporated into a book that claimed to be inspired. You know, trying to think through his reasoning here. If Ellen White did not do all the work in the preparation of a book, including the selections from the other authors, how could this book be considered inspired? What level of inspiration do you give to this book if other people helped to prepare it? And so on. This was a huge conundrum for Prescott and some of the other colleagues of Ellen White. And so Prescott said this, "Here is my difficulty. I have gone over the suggested changes to the Great Controversy that ought to be made in order to correct some statements," because Prescott had found out that the earlier editions of the Great Controversy were not accurate in some of the details presented. More recent scholarly works on some of these historical sections of the book showed that, you know, things should be said differently in the Great Controversy. And she accepted these changes. "Well, my personal difficulty," Prescott continues, "will be to retain faith on those things that I cannot deal with on that basis." Prescott then commented to the attendees, "But I did not throw out the spirit of prophecy and have not yet, but I have had to adjust my view of things." You see, for Daniels and Prescott and the way they had been educated within Adventism, there was some kind of a de facto understanding of the inspiration of Ellen White to have been somehow verbal, inherent, and infallible. And that everything she wrote in testimonies or in books had somehow come directly from a word of inspiration from the Holy Spirit. Well, look and behold, Prescott knew firsthand by experience that that is not the case. But there is more to the story. There is also the book, The Desire of Ages. Now, Ellen White had prepared The Desire of Ages through many years and again, many different editions through her ministry. And in 1898, she published the book that we know today as The Desire of Ages. But now The Desire of Ages, like the other books of Ellen White, was not really put together by Ellen White. Since 1878 or thereabout, Ellen White had employed a young woman by the name of Marion Davis. I'm sorry, I should have put her name there on the slide, Marion Davis, whom Ellen White in-house called her my bookmaker. Well, here is what she meant by Marion Davis being her bookmaker. And I relate that story in the 125th edition of the book Steps to Christ that was published by Andrews University Press a few years ago in preparation for the 125th anniversary of the book. I prepared a special annotated edition of Steps to Christ published by Andrews University. And in the historical introduction to the special edition, I explain how the book Steps to Christ came about, how it was put together by Marion Davis, and I give illustration and also in appendix how the book was put together. You see, Marion Davis was Ellen White's bookmaker, and by bookmaker Ellen White meant it is really Marion Davis who composed the book by compiling from the writings of Ellen White material that would fit into the various chapters of the various books that Marion Davis worked on. 1898, the Great Controversy, 1892, Steps to Christ. But there is about 10 books altogether that Marion Davis prepared while she worked for Ellen White. It's a fairly good list of books. And if you look at them, all of the precious books in our library are found in that list. Yes, Marion Davis worked on all these books, and that is how they were prepared. There are only one, two, maybe three books of Ellen White that Ellen White prepared cover to cover. There are the very, very first books of Ellen White, published in 1851 to 55, thereabout. Experience and Views, Supplement to Experience and Views, and then the Spiritual Gifts series in the late 1850s. They are the only books, really, of Ellen White that Ellen White prepared cover to cover. After those books, the books of Ellen White are basically compilations, recycling of material that Ellen White had already published, letters and manuscripts of Ellen White, unpublished, and then all the articles that she had published in the Review and after that in the Signs. The material from these places were put together into themes, into topics, into chapters, and into books. Marion Davis was the assistant of Ellen White that did that work. Essentially, she did it for Ellen White under the supervision of Ellen White with the assistance of Ellen White, but it is really the work of Marion Davis. Today, if the books of Ellen White published during the life of Ellen White were published today, it's very likely that on the title page of the books of Ellen White, the name of Marion Davis would be added as a co-author, or at least with the assistance of Marion Davis. At least a preface or an introduction would mention the role of Ellen White's literary assistance in the preparation of the book. But that was a different time and place, different ethos, and different publication ways of doing things. And so we just leave it at that. Daniels and Prescott's knew by experience with Ellen White that is how her books were put together. And that led them to set aside any inclination whatsoever toward a verbal inspiration of the writings of Ellen White. But also, to a large extent, they set aside even thought inspiration. It did not seem to be an entirely adequate model for them either. It just did not seem to work that way. So two problems therefore arose for Prescott, Daniels, and a few others. And that's why they were so guarded during the 1919 Bible Conference. The first problem is, if they affirmed that Ellen White's writings were not to be used as the final word on the interpretation or the validation of some controverted historical or scientific fact or biblical interpretation of prophecy, they would be accused of not believing in their inspiration. You see, already by 1919, Adventist expositors, evangelists, had almost convinced the entire membership that the inspiration of Ellen White's writings meant that they were infallible and inerrant. That was the de facto belief within the Adventist Church by then. And therefore, they were used as the last word on matters of controverted historical and scientific facts. Period. That's it. Now, a second problem for Daniels and Prescott is that they faced had to do with how the membership would react to knowing so much facts and details about how Ellen White really prepared their books or her books. There was great fear among participants of the Bible Conference that if any of them admitted openly this information, the membership in general would lose faith in her writings and likely many of them would leave the church. And so that was the other problem. So they were caught in between the two problems. G.B. Thompson was a field secretary of the General Conference at the time, also fairly well acquainted with the issues. He said this the evening of August 1. It seems to me that if we are going to preach the testimonies and establish confidence in them, so establish Ellen White as the end-time messenger of the Lord for the remnant church, it does not depend on whether they're verbally inspired or not. We should not connect believing in Ellen White as a guide for the church and believing in her verbal inspiration at the same time. I think we are now in this fix because of a wrong education that our people have had. If we had always taught the truth on this question, we would not have any trouble or shock in the denomination now. But the shock is because we have not taught the truth and have put the testimonies on a plane and all the writings of Ellen White on a plane where she says they do not stand. We have claimed more for them than she did. My thought is this, that the evidence in the inspiration of Ellen White's testimonies is not in their verbal inspiration, but in their influence and in the power that they have done, you know, the help, the guidance they have provided for the denomination in our personal lives. But the question remains, doesn't it? 100 years later, what role do we, you and I, as church leaders and scholars in the proper education of our church membership regarding these questions of inspiration, the preparation of Ellen White's books, and the role that they should play in our heritage? Have things changed that much? What have we learned, and how differently should we do our work of properly educating the membership? Rather than facing a puzzled membership and irate colleagues and creating confusion, these GC leaders in 1919 decided to bury the transcript of the conference. That's what they decided to do. The truth was inconvenient. We should be careful, however, considering and thinking carefully about the context in which they were. The denomination was just coming out of the Great War, World War I, the catastrophe, the millions of people dead. The Spanish flu, a pandemic, had just finished. These early leaders really, really believed that the second coming of Jesus was right around the corner within a year or two. They truly, truly believed that. So why cause a kerfuffle of some kind, creating confusion by revealing all these things about the writings of Ellen White, differences of interpretation regarding the prophecies, the sanctuary, regarding the Ottoman Empire and the plagues and the trumpets and on and on and on. Why confuse the people? Jesus is coming anyway. So let's hush the whole conversation. But that was 100 years ago. By concealing the conversations of the 1919 Bible Conference, these church leaders set the denomination on a course, on a historical course, that changed its core values and influenced core beliefs regarding Ellen White's ministry for future generations. Their decision changed the course and the development of our fundamental beliefs and of our denomination. By refusing to openly, candidly, own up to these conversations, to these troubling points that they were discussing, or at least putting them on the table, they really influenced the future of our denomination. What later generations, so that's you and I, and your parents and your grandparents, received was biased and mistakenly informed as far as the understanding of Ellen White's writings are concerned. Ellen White's afterlife took on aspects of a mythology. That's a theme of George Knight's book that I referred to earlier, Ellen White's Afterlife. It took on aspects of a mythology. What we have here is a natural evolution of a tradition or a received belief as it is shaped and crafted by some information and by the lack of other kinds of information. What later generations come to believe is different from what earlier generations knew, unknowingly and unconsciously, but sometimes intentionally and purposefully, a community's experience of its faith shapes and transforms what future generations come to understand what God is saying to them. I hope you're catching what's happening here. Is that we lived through a history since the 1950s, 60s, perhaps more closely the 70s and the 80s, we lived through a history in Adventism that was shaped by the lack of information given to the denomination after the 1919 Bible Conference. That's just the way things happened. A religious group's beliefs and practices are received from one generation to the next. References to progressive truth, you know, we talk about that often, or we believe in progressive truth, that God continues to reveal truth to his people. Sometimes in our particular context and conversation today here, sometimes I find that to be a naive understanding of this process. What we believe today is more the result of what we inherited from the last few generations than the result of the discovery of progressive truth. Really, honestly, regarding these questions discussed in 1919, it is a whole lot more what has happened. Some scholars have studied these kinds of things that are happening to denominations and how they change their beliefs over time. One of them is Ormond Rush, and he created a model in the 1990s, a model of four bipolar issues that he tried to use to explain how beliefs change within a religious community. And I'm going to use his model to try to superimpose it upon Adventism. This model understands the role of the reception from one generation to the next of what we believe, rather than the discovery of progressive truth. And I think this fits quite well for a number of our beliefs. Here are the four bipolar issues: continuity, discontinuity in our beliefs, unity, plurality, clarity, ambiguity, and also normativity and relativity. Here's what happened. In our church, today, there is certainly a great deal of continuity with our very early pioneers regarding the health reform, Sabbath observance, believing in the second coming of Jesus, and so on. There's a lot of continuity. There is as well, however, some discontinuity. We do no longer believe in an Arian understanding of Jesus. We fully affirm a triune understanding of God and a more deeper understanding of the atonement on the cross. We have changed this discontinuity, certainly with Joseph Bates, when it comes to some of these beliefs. And so from one generation to the next, we inherit some continuity. We also inherit some discontinuity. Somebody in the last few generations cut loose when it came to the Trinity and the atonement, and perhaps a number of others. Cut the umbilical cord, so that belief is no longer part of a continuum. There's discontinuity. As far as unity and plurality, the same thing can be seen here. In our church today, because of the reception of our beliefs from one generation to the next, in the last, let's say, three or four generations, there is certainly unity when it comes to church governance and church structure. We are fairly strong in having one big, huge structure. World Church tends to be on the episcopal side of things. The Ellen White's gift of the church to the church in the past, that's fairly well accepted. But you know that there is plurality of views when it comes to some details, to some practices. We believe in one big church governance structure, but when it comes to the understanding of ordination, well, there's some plurality there. And there is more and more of it as the months and the years go by. Same thing with the meaning of Ellen White's gift to the church today. There is some plurality. There is unity with the past. There's plurality as to how we understand that past and how we look at it and accept it. Another bipolar issue has to do with clarity and ambiguity. Some doctrines are clear, at least to us today. God as Trinity, Christ's full vindication of God at the cross. Oh, but I tell you, given these two points of doctrines, there is some ambiguity among us. There are still some Seventh-day Adventists who hold some to some non-Trinitarian views. And sometimes the way we explain the Trinity is really not Trinitarian. So there's ambiguity there. And how about what Jesus accomplished on the cross and what he is accomplishing in the sanctuary right now? There is certainly ambiguity for a large segment of Adventism that is within a concept of the last generation theology. Not everything is clear. A lot of things are ambiguous. Well, that's an inheritance that we have received from the last three generations or so within Adventism. So it's not always progressive truth here. It is really the reception of clarity and reception of ambiguity. The last bipolar model or issue is an issue of normativity and relativity. Some doctrines are very normative, others are very relative. Some documents are normative, 28 fundamental beliefs, the church manual, our church policies. But you know as much as I do, that any of these documents in some parts of Adventism is very relative. Yeah, it's a good guidance book, not a rule book, and so on. And relativity, really, only God is really normative when you think of it. And all truth is humanly understood to a large extent. So there's going to be some relativity and normativity in all of our beliefs and in all of what we hold dear. Well, let me wrap this up here when it comes to Adventism. 100 years ago, we can see that decisions made after the conference impacted what future generations received from our heritage and how it shaped what we've become, what we now experience. For good or for bad, history cannot be undone. I think I want to be clear about this here. I don't want to demonize anybody here this afternoon. And I don't think we should. For good or for bad, this is our history. And there are consequences to the actions of former church leaders, teachers, and pastors. Yeah, there are consequences. They did not think they were doing anything harmful by simply putting aside the transcripts of the Bible conference. By the way, I did not say that, but it was normative. It was very normal practices in the many, many years of the Adventist church that the transcripts of a Bible conference, of any conference, were published in the church. Bible conferences, institutes of our church through the years, the talks who said what, the topics discussed, the sermons preached, all of that was routinely published in the Review, in the Signs of the Times, in local union papers, and so on. But not this Bible conference. They broke with tradition by hiding those transcripts. And they had their reasons for doing this. The decision to not release the transcripts of the discussions, the persistent lack of transparency about the writings of Ellen White, and how they were prepared and their role in shaping our religious beliefs and theology, the lack of honesty about the difficult interpretational issues history and Bible teachers faced, created and allowed a context that shaped the Adventist religious experience for generations since then. The heritage we have received and that we cherish today was unconsciously and unknowingly shaped by their decisions. History cannot be undone, and 100 years later, 102 now, our context has been shaped by their context. So our experience as a denomination today is embodying the reception of their experience and their heritage, and we experience these four bipolar issues in our church. This is what we have received from Daniels and Prescott and others, for good or for bad. That's just who we are. When in the 1970s, the transcripts of the 1919 Bible Conference were, quote, discovered in the archives of the General Conference. By the way, if you have not listened to it, go to the Adventist Today website. Earlier this week, Lauren posted an interview that he had with Auge Rendalen about 3 or 4 years ago about how he, as a student worker here at Andrews University, saw the transcripts of the Bible conference and provided photocopies of it to about 50 people here on campus. And that launched, you know, a huge wave of what is this all about type of reaction to the Bible conference. Anyway, when in the 1970s, these transcripts were rediscovered, when colleagues became aware a little bit more of Ellen White's dependency on secondary sources for some of her most important works and ideas, many church members and scholars were shaken by these discoveries. Isn't that intriguing? This is exactly what Prescott and Daniels were afraid of in 1919, that if they were candid and revealing all that information to everybody, people were would be shaken. Some people would leave the church. Some people would be angry, deceived, and feel left out, and so on. Isn't that something? Well, they were almost prophets, because this is exactly what happened. We could have avoided these difficult years of the 1970s and 1980s if these revelations had been given to the church right from the get-go in the early 1920s. Instead of having, you know, Walter Ray, Ron Numbers, Desmond Ford, in some ways reveal to the church what they discovered and how the church reacted very defensively to what they said, because it seemed to be denigrating the ministry of Ellen White. If all that information had been known, we wouldn't have had to go through these anxiety years of the 70s and the 80s. Maybe history would be different. But again, for good or for bad, that's our history. Lack of honesty and intellectual integrity opened the door for spiritual traumas that we experienced in the 70s and the 80s. And further lack of transparency will continue to lead to more trauma in the years to come. You know, the result of all of this is that we have not really experienced a discovery of progressive truth, but rather we have been shaped by the results of decisions made a few generations ago. So here it is. The end result of all of this is that we will continue to live and experience these four bipolar issues. The best church leaders and educators will help us to navigate this experience and not demonize anyone who interprets this history, experience, and results in different ways. We have to adjust our view of things if we want to continue to offer a meaningful contribution to the world. Thank you for your attention. I'll turn the time back over to you. Yes.
Yes.